August 31st, Daily Video Bible Reading from the Net Bible, Isaiah chapters 8 and 9 from the Old Testament. The Lord told me, take a large tablet and inscribe these words on it with an ordinary stylus, Meher Shalal Hashbaz. Then I will summon as my reliable witnesses Uriah the priest and Zechariah, son of Jeberechiah. I then had sexual relations with the prophetess. She conceived and gave birth to a son. The Lord told me, name him Meher Shalal Hashbaz. For before the child knows how to cry out, my father or my mother, the wealth of Damascus and the plunder of Samaria will be carried off by the king of Assyria. The Lord spoke to me again. These people have rejected the gently flowing waters of Shiloah and melt in fear over Rezin and the son of Remaliah. So look, the sovereign master is bringing up against them the turbulent and mighty waters of the Euphrates River, the king of Assyria and all his majestic power. It will reach flood stage and overflow its banks. It will spill into Judah, flooding and engulfing as it reaches to the necks of its victims. He will spread his wings out over your entire land, O Emmanuel. You will be broken, O nations. You will be shattered. Pay attention, all you distant lands of the earth. Get ready for battle, and you will be shattered. Get ready for battle, and you will be shattered. Devise your strategy, but it will be thwarted. Issue your orders, but they will not be executed, for God is with us. Indeed, this is what the Lord told me. He took hold of me firmly and warned me not to act like these people. Do not say conspiracy every time these people say the word. Don't be afraid of what scares them. Don't be terrified. You must recognize the authority of the Lord who commands armies. He is the one you must respect. He is the one you must fear. He will become a sanctuary, but a stone that makes a person trip, and a rock that makes one stumble. To the two houses of Israel, he will become a trap and a snare to the residents of Jerusalem. Many will stumble over the stone and the rock and will fall and be seriously injured and will be ensnared and captured. Tie up the scroll as legal evidence, seal the official record of God's instructions, and give it to my followers. I will wait patiently for the Lord, who has rejected the family of Jacob. I will wait for him. Look, I and the sons whom the Lord has given me are reminders and object lessons in Israel, sent from the Lord who commands armies, who lives on Mount Zion. They will say to you, seek oracles at the pitch used to conjure up underworld spirits from the magicians who chirp and mutter incantations. Should people not seek oracles from their gods by asking the dead about the destiny of the living? Then you must recall the Lord's instructions and the prophetic testimony of what would happen. Certainly they say such things because their minds are spiritually darkened. They will pass through the land destitute and starving. Their hunger will make them angry, and they will curse their king and their God as they look upward. When one looks out over the land, he sees distress and darkness, gloom and anxiety, darkness and people forced from the land. The gloom will be dispelled for those who are anxious. In earlier times, he humiliated the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but now he brings honor to the way of the sea, the region beyond the Jordan and the Galilee of the nations. The people walking in darkness see a bright light. Light shines on those who live in a land of deep darkness. You have enlarged the nation. You give them great joy. They rejoice in your presence as harvesters rejoice, as warriors celebrate when they divide up the plunder. For their oppressive yoke and the club that strikes their shoulders, the cudgel the oppressor uses on them, you have shattered as in the day of Midian's defeat. Indeed, every boot that marches and shakes the earth and every garment dragged through blood is used as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born to us, a son has been given to us. He shoulders responsibility and is called Extraordinary Strategist, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His dominion will be vast, and he will bring immeasurable prosperity. He will rule on David's throne and over David's kingdom, establishing it and strengthening it by promoting justice and fairness from this time forward and forevermore. The Lord's intense devotion to his people will accomplish this. The Sovereign Master decreed judgment on Jacob, and it fell on Israel. All the people were aware of it, the people of Ephraim and those living in Samaria. Yet with pride and an arrogant attitude, they said, "The bricks have fallen, but we will rebuild with chiseled stone. The sycamore fig trees have been cut down, but we will replace them with cedars." Then the Lord provoked their adversaries to attack them. He stirred up their enemies. Syria from the east and the Philistines from the west, they gobbled up Israelite territory. Despite all this, his anger does not subside, and his hand is ready to strike again. The people did not return to the one who struck them. They did not seek reconciliation with the Lord who commands armies. So the Lord cut off Israel's head and tail, both the shoots and stalk, in one day. The leaders and the highly respected people are the head. The prophets who teach lies are the tail. The leaders of this nation were misleading people, and the people being led were destroyed. So the Sovereign Master was not pleased with their young men. He took no pity on their orphans and widows. For the whole nation was godless and did wicked things. Every mouth was speaking disgraceful words. Despite all this, his anger does not subside, and his hand is ready to strike again. For evil burned like a fire, it consumed thorns and briars, it burnt up the thickets of the forest, and they went up in smoke. Because of the anger of the Lord who commands armies, the land was scorched, and the people became fuel for the fire. People had no compassion on one another. They devoured on the right, but were still hungry. They ate on the left, but were not satisfied. People even ate the flesh of their own arm. Manasseh fought against Ephraim, and Ephraim against Manasseh. Together they fought against Judah. Despite all this, his anger does not subside, and his hand is ready to strike again. God, I know that in these couple chapters of Isaiah, that he's talking about a lot of things. He's talking about war. He's talking about what's currently happening. He's talking about what's going to happen in the future. He's talking about your people who are being obedient, your people who are being disobedient. But amongst all of this, there is a phrase that I think we need to stop and talk about. In verse 6, where it says, "He shoulders responsibility and is called Extraordinary Strategist, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." And you are many, many, many things, many which we are still learning all of your true characters and your many facets. But I was thinking about the Everlasting Father one. I think about that one a lot. There seems to be so many people in my life who've left. My dad died. My best friend was killed. There's other people who have chosen to leave my life. There's other people I've kicked out of my life for all the right reasons. And looking back on my life, it seems very transitory. Now, I'm sure that's not true for everyone listening to the video, but I'm sure everyone listening has had somebody leave their life and have possibly felt betrayed by that. Maybe they even had their own father betray them in some way. All I know is everlasting is permanent. It's forever and ever. There's no change in the word everlasting. It is always. That you will always be my father. You will always be the person who loves me more than anyone else, protects me, takes care of me, disciplines me, allows me to grow, and teaches me what I need to know. There's so many other things that you are to me, God. But when I think of all of the people who've come and gone in my life, and some of them I don't even remember their names, the only one that is constant to me is you. I haven't been constant to you, but you've always been constant to me. I know Isaiah is talking about a lot of things here and a lot of the different principles of who you are. In fact, even later on, he talks about how
men or countries can be arrogant and fight battles, but it's not going to change your mind. So we also know you're steadfast and you're strong and you cannot be moved. And throughout the Bible, we can easily see a lot of the different pieces of your character. But just that comforting word of a father, this amazing sovereign God of the Old Testament, who destroyed nations and commanded armies and decided the results of people's lives, sometimes by swallowing them up into the earth. That same God wants to wrap his arms around me and watch over me and love me and teach me and protect me. God, I don't understand why you're willing to do that. I don't understand why you love us that much. But I am thankful that I know you'll never leave. I don't have a lot of absolutes in my life. I know I will absolutely sin. I know that people will come in and out of my life, and a lot of times that's going to hurt. But my one absolute is that you, without a doubt, without question, will always be there for me, will never leave me. You promise to never forsake me. You promise to always want what is best for me. And you've promised to love me. God, there are so many other things that you bring to my life besides just that one little phrase. But that one little phrase to somebody that's had a lot of people in her life damage her, intentionally or unintentionally. The comfort of knowing that I have an eternal, everlasting Father allows my heart to heal and to realize that these earthly, worldly relationships are eventually going to fall away. And the one relationship that has always been there with me throughout all of these other relationships, that's the one that will last past death. That's the one that I will get to keep for all time. And obviously, without a doubt, it's the most important relationship. God, thank you for the lovingness and the gentleness and the comfortingness of you being my father. I know a lot of times you have to discipline me like a dad would, but I know it's all out of love. Thank you for being endlessly big, bigger than I can even imagine, and yet so relationally small that you want to have an intimate relationship with me. It's baffling to me how that works. But today especially, I'm just glad it works. In your son's name I pray. Amen.